48-game test this week, 30-year-old Pete Weber stands atop the leaderboard. And with a victory tonight, would become the PBA's number two all-time leading money winner. And welcome, everyone, to Woodland Bowl, located in Indianapolis, Indiana. Hi, everybody. I'm Denny Schreiner, and welcome to the Touring Players Championship, a major championship on the PBA Tour. And the lanes were very difficult this week. As a matter of fact, rumors were running rampant that the PBA lane maintenance crew spilled more oil on these lanes than the Exxon Valdez, Mike Durbin. Very tough, very tight conditions this week.
Yeah, we talked to a number of players earlier, and they were saying it's one of the tightest conditions that they've ever bowled on. But as you said, this is a major tournament, the Touring Players Championship. And it's always been PBA lane maintenance policy that in the major championships, the lanes get tougher. An analogy would be like they shrink the fairways, they let the rough grow, they put the pins in tough positions. And usually the guys that make the best shots are the ones that win these tournaments.
A year ago, Pete Weber ended up winning the U.S. Open on this very pair of lanes. But from the top seed position, Mike, in his career, he is just 5-6, despite having an excellent winning percentages on national television.
Well, one of the reasons he's 5-6 is because he's won so often coming from the bottom. He won the Firestone Tournament of Champions coming from the bottom, and he won last year the U.S. Open right here coming from the bottom. And as we look at this graphic right here, we see that he's made the telecast 61 times. He has a winning percentage of 602, and look who he's just ahead, his old man.
Mr. Weber, who will be in attendance here this evening. Let's talk now about our number two seed, Harry Sullins. He's the Iron Man on the tour. He has bowled 207 consecutive events, and if not for a loss in the position round game last night, he might have been the top seed.
And he's bowled very well in this center. He won here a number of years ago. He needs just 28 more tournaments in a row to tie Sam Flanagan for the Iron Man Award, you know. If I bowl that many, they'd have to take me to an institution.
Norm Duke, our number three seed a year ago, was a very serious candidate to win Bowler of the Year honors. He's back, has had another solid year this year, and he is a threat from that number three spot.
And this is his fifth championship round appearance. One of the reasons he's such a threat is he's so good from every angle, and he's developing the reputation as maybe the best in the clutch right now.
Earlier this summer on ESPN, you watched Justin Hromek and Dick Weber team up to win the Touring Pro Senior Doubles Championship, but tonight Justin will have to go it alone to try and win his first PBA title.
And he told me this is his first championship round by himself. Be interesting if he gets all the way up to bowl with Pete. Dick won't be rooting for him tonight, but if he bowls as well as he did with Dick, everybody better look out.
I know that you can relate to Rich Abboud and what happened to him last night. He was leading this tournament heading into the final eight games, had some problems, and he was seventh heading into the position round, but he mustered a 245 game, defeated Mike Albee, and ended up on the telecast.
Well, the way he did that, you know, he'd been playing inside all night long and just slowly sliding down that slippery rope. When he got to the position round, he took out a dull ball, he moved out to the first arrow, shot 240. That bold move got him to the telecast tonight.
And we've got $27,000 to give away to our first place winner here tonight. The opening match just about ready to start, featuring Rich Abboud, who moved from seventh to fifth, and also Justin Hromek. And Justin Hromek opens up championship round play. Pair of lanes, 59 and 60.
Yeah, one difference already, Denny. The lanes are hooking more today, and everybody has moved outside. Where they couldn't get a hook outside before, now the ball's swinging back a little bit.
Talked about those varying conditions. If you're going to win a major, you have to be able to play everywhere on the PBA Tour.
And Justin sends it wide, gets it back. He's happy with just the two pin at this point in time.
You mentioned that the players have all moved out, maybe 8-10 boards from where they played throughout the week. And when I asked Justin about that, he said, well, you know, it's going to be difficult for me because I was really comfortable with where I was playing before. It's an interesting note. You as a player many times led tournaments, made telecasts, came back the next day and the lanes were completely different. How do you deal with that mentally?
Well, the way you deal with it is if you can find a shot that you're comfortable with at the time. I was fortunate enough to be able to do that a number of times and made it work for me. If you can't get comfortable, then usually you struggle and you wind up losing.
First shot in the championship round for Rich Abboud. Not exactly what he was hoping for. Turned a little early, but got a break.
Well, nine and a spare, and he's going to be happy. We got two guys here in their first appearance ever, you know, as singles in a championship round. So both of them are going to be a little bit nervous and have to feel it out. They can mark the first two or three frames. They're going to be happy. Rich with a nice free swing. Knees pre-bent to start. pushes and steps at the same time. Ball's a little bit early there. Catches up right there. Pretty square at the line. Nice knee bend. A little bit turned at the line.
Out of Omaha, Nebraska. 5'6", 160 pounds, 33 years of age. And just thrilled to death to be in the championship round.
Much more relaxed and better shot there. That ball came off his hand really clean at that point.
Finished eighth earlier this year on the PBA Tour down in Homestead, Florida.
And if you notice that Justin Hromek here has a grip on his index finger. If you see that yellow thing right up against the ball there, that's an actual grip that usually goes in the bowling ball. He's put it on because if he doesn't have something there, he gets a blister on that finger.
Perfect shot on lane 60. And there you see him adjusting that grip on the index finger.
Justin holding the ball waist high all the way at the back of the approach there. Five-step player. Pushes it out now. A little controlled swing here. See where it is at the top here. Right in time right there. Look at that cupped wrist. Rolls the hand around. Follow through went left. You see that? The foot turned a little bit at the line.
He had a great comment when I asked him about bowling the singles as opposed to the doubles. And he said, well, I'm going to have to figure out both lanes. In the doubles, I was locked in on the left-hand lane bowling with Mr. Weber.
Right. Big difference.
Looking for a double. And a beautiful shot by one of the top collegiate players in the country through the later part of the 80s. 4 years in a row bowling for Wichita State. And all 4 years, Wichita State was ranked in the top three in the country.
Boys turned out good bowlers. Rich trying for a double. Right there, pretty shot.
Perfect shot for Rich Abboud. And I had a chance to talk to him earlier today about what happened last night and the difficulty of getting to the championship round.
It was very tough. I had the lead going into the last round of the tournament, and I couldn't win a game. I came out like 0-5, and I finally dropped all the way to 7th and had a double in the 10th to come from 7th to 5th, and it was just emotion-ridden. I was up and I was down, and then I got back up again, so it worked out really well.
Calls for it to come back. It does. All of a sudden, these players look lined up on lanes 59 and 60.
Well, that one, he swung a little bit wider at that point in time, and it made it back. Here's a replay. Sends it out. Watch how far out it gets, about to the third board at about 40 feet. It still makes it back flush. When that happens, you send it a board wide, your eyes light up.
The difference a day makes. When I talked to Rich about the lanes, he said, boy, these are a lot different than what I used or what I pulled on throughout the week and the equipment that I used as well. So Justin Hromek trying to maintain pace right now. Players as a group averaged about 217 on this pair of balls.
Did you see him just shred that rack on that shot? The bowler track, he starts it at 12, gets out to 6 at 30 feet. So 6 board belly at that point, already started back at board 45 feet rather. There isn't a 45th board. You're doing pretty well for the first time on TV.
You're not kidding. Norm Duke next in line. Harry Sullins is qualified number 2. And Pete Weber is trying to win his 5th title in this bowling center. He's already got a U.S. Open victory and 3 regional titles here at Woodland Bowl.
That's twice he's come up light on that left lane. Looks like 59 is the more difficult of the two lanes for Justin. He's in deeper and sending it further right than Rich Abboud. Rich going straighter.
Solid year for Justin Hromek, who has cashed in 20 out of 27 PBA events. One of the bright young stars on the PBA Tour.
Yeah. Notice how he went hard and straight at the spare. Don't have to throw a hook to knock that one pin down.
Re-rack for Rich Abboud, who is currently working on a 3-bagger right now and could take the lead with a strike here.
High. 3-6-10. That's the don't send it too wide. Turn it a little bit early and soft speed shot right there. This is caused by mental, not thinking properly. See the hand go down, left of target, and the speed was softer too. No split though. Should be able to make this spare. Oh. no trouble.
But instead of having a chance to take the lead, Michael, now he trails by two in the match.
Yeah, but anytime you hit the nose, Dan, and you come away with a spare, you're saying, okay.
It's interesting because Justin Hromek averaged 191 on this pair of lanes, and Rich Abboud averaged 240.
A little bit of difference. Of course, this is a different day, too.
Oh, yeah. Great game last night, though. Beat Mike Albee 245 to 220 to jump from seventh place all the way to fifth. A much looser arm swing there. He trusted that shot and got a nice result.
Well, he's got the exact opposite reaction. Looks like he likes the left lane better than the right.
They should be bowling doubles together.
Yes.
Maybe they will next year. Justin Hromek and Rich Abboud in a very good match here in Indianapolis.
We always thought we knew a lot about Bud. Great taste, king of beers, that kind of stuff.
But these guys.
Budweiser, it's Beechwood aged.
Whoa.
Naturally carbonated.
Takes a long time to brew.
Where'd they learn this stuff? Some brewmaster information pipeline? Long forgotten, perhaps, deep in their collective subconscious?
No, I think it was on TV.
Here comes the king, here comes the big number one.
You know, working at AutoZone is more than looking up parts or ringing up sales. Most of all, it's listening. Because my customers know more about their cars than I'll ever know. They know every rattle by heart. I mean, that car is their baby. So when they've got a problem they're going to fix for themselves, I'm going to do my best to help them get whatever they need, no matter what it takes. Because people like that, they don't deserve anything less than the best I can give them.
The championship round finals of the Bud Light Touring Players Championship are being brought to you by Anheuser. Justin Hromek now in the seventh. While we were away, he left a solid 10 pin in the sixth and converted the spare and looks for a Walsh shaker that doesn't quite get the job done, leaves the seventh pin.
And again, he's been light every time on lane 59. Got one strike out of four shots. If he makes a spare, Dan, we got an even match. Here we see it coming in light on the head pin. The 4, 5, 7 is there. The 4 and the 5 go down and they hit the 7 pin. Not enough to knock it over. Dead center.
Even match as Rich Abboud stands up in the seventh, but he could change that scenario with a double here.
Well, again, he had the same opportunity in the fifth frame, so he gets a second chance on the same lane. Let's see what he does. More room.
A lot more room.
Ooh, look at that. Whoa. That one almost banked back.
Ah, yes. And Don is very appreciative of the effort there, especially because it was for a double.
Yes. Watch how far he gets this ball right. Out to maybe the first or second board and all the way back. Come on. Yes.
He looked a tad nervous at about 20 feet.
Well, is it
don't
is
you think?
Going to slide off? Gave that one room, too.
Well, you're right. He likes the left-hand lane, and Justin likes the right-hand lane. But Rich Abboud comes up with a couple of big strikes and takes the lead here in the latter stages of match number one. Now let's see if Justin Hromek can rise to the occasion. Handful on that shot. He's down 20, but if he throws another strike, he's back into the match. And I also had a chance to talk to Justin, and I said, hey, you won the doubles with Dick Weber, but now you have to figure out how to win this thing on your own.
Yeah, it was a luxury having Dick Weber to bowl with for my first title, and not many people have that, but tonight it's going to be by myself. It's going to be a little different. I'll have both lanes to figure out instead of just one of them like I did in the doubles, and a lot of good competition, so it's going to be good matches tonight. A lot of good players. Anybody can win this.
And this is the biggest shot of the week for him right now. He must strike here to bite into that 20-pin lead, cut it to 10, set himself up for the 10th frame.
An aggressive shot. And last time it was the 7-pin. This time it's the 10-pin. So he's a player that's hit the pocket tonight, Michael, but the carry wasn't quite there.
Not quite there, especially on the left lane. Only one strike on the left lane, 1 out of 5 over there.
Already won a couple of PBA regionals. As I mentioned, he's already captured a doubles title. He was looking for PBA singles championship number one. Going to be tough to get that now.
He has to hope that Rich Abboud opens somewhere in here.
Rich goes with another re-rack on lane 60. Strike here puts him up by 30.
Yeah, basically puts the match out of the wood.
Well, he didn't flirt with the one board, and guess what? He just paid the price for not swinging the ball far enough.
See the thumb go down again, Dan? Again, it's a mental battle with yourself. Just make yourself stay behind that ball and trust it right. But at the last second, sometimes the courage fails and we steer it up high. The 3-6-7-10 is a makeable split. You must, it's like shooting the baby split. Hit the three pin on the right, the ball takes out the 6-10, send the three pin over to the seven.
He's gonna give it a run. Very close indeed, but an open frame, almost like an unforced error in tennis, Mike. I mean, he had the set one, and all of a sudden he hit it into the net a couple of times.
Now he has to regroup mentally, because if he goes strike spare, Hromek can double in the 10th and beat him. Rich has to double in the 10th frame to shut him out now.
This has been the better of the two lanes, though, lane 59 for Rich Abboud. Doesn't waste much time, goes up, throws a perfect shot.
And while he's throwing that shot, Justin Hromek is taking a re-rack on lane 60, so he's getting himself ready. However, that re-rack won't amount to much if Rich strikes on this shot.
Threw a couple of clutch strikes last night to get to the telecast, and that's what's so tough on the PBA Tour. You have to do it on Tuesday night and then come back on Wednesday and do a lot of the same.
He struck every time on this lane so far.
For the lockout.
High. A little soft with the speed, and Don takes a deep breath, says, that's okay. I still love you.
Boy, that support is so helpful. When you're out there all alone, yeah, when you're out there all alone, few people ever realize, unless you've played out there and you understand what's going through your mind, there's nobody out there helping you. The ball can get pretty heavy when the pressure's on. A very solid game for Rich Abboud, but a game that he could have easily put away had he executed in the right spots.
That's experience, Dan. Right now, Justin Hromek is going to gain some experience, either positive or negative. He can double in the 10th frame to win this match.
A lot of roll. Light hit. What about the messenger? Not going to get there. Justin Hromek can do nothing but turn around, congratulate Rich Abboud, who says, unfortunate to get by this opening match.
Great shot there by Justin. I mean, absolutely. Great shot. Mm.
Had the light 7 and the light 10 on the left-hand lane. Threw a good shot there, but for Hromek, it's a fifth-place finish. When we come back to Indianapolis, we'll have a Mike Durbin average builder concerning practice. Bowl with the world's greatest.
Share with you. The first of these is that when we go to practice, that we have some specific plan in mind. I think all too often we show up at practice, we throw balls down the lane, but we really don't gain a lot from it. So have a specific thing that you're working on each time. It may be your push away one time, it may be your timing another time, it may be your hand release another time. The second thing is scorekeeping. I think a lot of us try and use practice as a confidence builder for when we go into competition. And I really think this can work in reverse and lead us to a letdown. So I recommend not keeping score at all when you practice, or if you're forced to with automatic scoring units, that you just disregard the score. The third thing is spare shooting. Last week we talked about spares being the backbone of the average league bowler's game. And there are different products coming on the market now that tell us where to stand and where to aim. But we still need to get out there and practice. And we especially need to practice our single pin spares. And I think the single pin spares that probably give us the most trouble are the 10 pin and the 7 pin. So I recommend that you take at least one game out of your practice session where you shoot one of those two pins out of a full rack first. Now I'm going to try and shoot the 10 pin out of a full rack, or I did earlier. We'll take a look at what I did here. Lined up here to the left side, shooting for the 10 pin first.
Well, I managed to get just the 10-pin. But you see, what I have left now is I have almost a full rack of pins. So I can move over now and try for a strike using my normal strike line. And what I've accomplished here is really three or four things. I practiced my difficult spare. I still have an opportunity to shoot the strike line and practice for the strike. So I've saved money by maximizing my practice time. And the icing on the cake is that when I hit the 1-3 pocket now, I don't have to worry about leaving that aggravating 10-pin. One other thing you might want to do is to call your local bowling center and see what special times and rates they have for practice. We'll see you again next week from Rochester, New York, where we'll have another average builder. And in the meantime, why don't you get out and practice some?
All right, 221 to 215. Rich Abboud, a winner in game number one. Very close match indeed. Let's take a look at the rest of the finishers this week. Dave Watka, very close. Jimmy Johnson had a chance in the last game to make the telecast.
Just missed, yeah. And the great Mike Albee from right here in Indianapolis, and Ron Palumbi, who won the U.S. Open here a few years ago.
Filling out the top 10, Mike Edwards with a solid week. Jeff Bellinger was 11th this week.
And moving on down, left-hander Scott Devers and Bob Learn Jr., who won earlier this year.
Rich Schisler out of Denver, Colorado. Dave Husted out of Milwaukee, Oregon was 15th.
And the great Marshall Holman, the all-time leading money winner, and Brian Goble.
18th and 19th, David Ozio, the PBA's current player of the year, and Eric Forkel, the leading money winner.
Bob Spalding really revs it up. And, of course, Justin Romick's friend and partner in college, Rick Steelsmith.
Rounding out the top 24, Dale Strike was 22nd, Mark Bowers was 23rd.
And Tony Westlake in an unfamiliar position for him, 24th. Charlie Standish was the alternate.
All right, when we come back, an outstanding match cooking for you here in Indianapolis. Norm Duke in the number three position. He'll take on Rich Abboud in the Bud Light Touring Players Championship.
You're about to see the power of subliminal advertising.
Look at the break point, too. That break point's down there about 50 feet, isn't it?
45 at least. And you see the reaction there? He was confident in that shot from the time he let it go. More speed on this lane. Much more speed on that lane.
Playing it outside and going much more direct, not hooking the ball much at all, almost like letting the lane hook the ball.
See, now he's showcasing his talent right here. I mean, this is what the players out here have seen him do now for the last 2 or 3 years. Right there, 15 feet is 5.5 to 3.5. So much straighter, and 18 miles an hour. The other one was 16.4. Same mistake that he's made.
Well, when you talk about Norm Duke, it's almost like a pitcher who has a 90-mile-an-hour fastball and yet can throw the changeup and get it over the plate.
And doing it at alternate times. I mean,
that's talent.
To throw one speed on one lane and then throw it 2 miles harder on the other lane is real talent. And a different angle, that is definitely talent.
Baby split. And Rich Abboud fits it in very nicely and takes out the 3 and the 10. Don't forget, coming your way on Friday night, it's National Hockey League action, the Montreal Canadiens and the New York Rangers. And all the action starts at 7:30 Eastern time. Marc Messier, one of the outstanding players in the National Hockey League. Canadiens, they might contend for the Stanley Cup before it's all over.
A lot of good teams in the NHL. Well, he's just so confident on that lane. The other lane, he makes a good shot about every third time.
Norm Duke, meanwhile, just maintaining pace with the first 4.
Look at those eyes.
Set it a little short. This one knifes through the head pin, 3-6-10 on lane 60.
Something bothered him. I don't know what it was, a 3-6-10. Speed was down just a little bit that time.
Yeah, and he also didn't get the ball as far right on that shot as he has on the other two.
No, he's not a machine.
Well, Obviously something is bothering him because he pulled up just before he got to the line.
He's hearing something. I don't know what he's hearing. Something is distracting his concentration. That's amazing to be able to stop there at the end of that.
Time to regroup now and shoot the 3-6-10.
Well, that's confidence to turn away from it. Thanks, Dale Herrick, the president, co-sponsor of the Central Bowling Indiana Bowling Proprietors.
Plenty of dignitaries on hand here this evening for the championship round. Is it me, or is Norm Duke the type of player that's going to hear every little thing?
I think that's an accurate assessment.
Some players handle a championship round differently than others. Perhaps it's one of the things that's held him back in championship round play. Good shot there. Kicks out the four pin. And Norm Duke right now in the lead and in control of match number two. When we come back, the conclusion. For Rich Abboud, but that came after the big four stood up in the sixth frame.
And he just loses his speed every now and then on that right lane. The left lane, he's relaxed and keeps the speed up over 17 miles per hour, and there's the result. He's got to concentrate on keeping that speed up on the right lane.
Norm Duke with more speed and more angle this trip, and guess what? He's right back with the 3-6-10.
And that snap hook right at the back end. He's been fortunate two times. That seven is a 3-6-10.
Guarantee you, he's puzzled because he threw that ball further right and with more velocity and ended up with the same reaction as the last time when he didn't make the good shot. Back up ball at the 3-6-10, covers that up. And let's take a look at how these players started the tournament and what positions and how they got to the championship round. Boy, look at Weber and Norm Duke. They were way down the list.
Yeah, 56 and 54. Duke has made a steady climb all the way up. He wants to continue that tonight.
Pete Weber moving from sixth to first in the final round. Terry Sullins is next in line. He's the number two seed. Pete Weber, our top seed. Pete Weber looking for his 19th career PBA championship.
Ooh, the four and the nine were there. The nine falls over. He put a piece of tape, he tore it out. Now he's tearing it again, quickly putting it in the ball. This is another ball. No, this is not that ball, this ball. Into the thumb hole. The feel is so important, Dan, if anything. That was just a little bitty strip of tape that he put in there, but it makes a difference. He gets a little practice at the spare. He throws it dead straight at those spares.
Solid game thus far for Norm Duke, who leads by 43. So he's probably already starting to think about the semifinal game.
Well, it's not over yet. Rich better strike here.
Rich could still shoot 223, but it's going to take some doing at this stage.
More speed. And it's still snap.
Well, obviously, the right-hand lane is breaking down.
But obviously, Rich Abboud just didn't adjust to it properly as he
look at Rich,
puts that smile on his face.
He knows.
So I thought I threw it good that time.
Sure. That's got to be the most difficult thing to deal with when you feel like you've made an adjustment, you've really thrown a good shot, and the ball still goes through the nose. I mean it's just not meant to be, right?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, basically, all you can expect of yourself is to get the ball off your hand clean to make the good shot. And when you think you've made the right adjustment, it doesn't turn out right, but then you have to live with the results.
Norm Duke still adding tape to get the right thumb hole size for his shot in the ninth frame. But he has the luxury of going up there with a huge lead. Rich says, see, it's easy. All I had to do was move a couple here and do this. Yeah,
he says this should have been the Turi Pro doubles or something here. We already had a ball in one lane.
Norm Duke eyeing the electronic scoreboard, and he realizes that he can coast into the next game.
He changed angles again, moved deeper inside, leaves the 1, 2, 8, 10. Well, he's been getting 7 and 7 on this right lane. Now he's gotten 6 in their part.
Nice luxury, though, to be so far ahead that you can go ahead and experiment before the next game.
Yeah, but what's he going to do the next time he gets on that lane in the next game against Sullins?
Probably strike.
He's trying for a strike now. He played for a strike on that spare shot. Never even fooled with making the spare.
Well, I mean, you have to at this point. He's obviously not comfortable with what's happening on that right-hand
lane. Well, that's a tremendous strategy to just basically throw away that frame to try and figure out the lane for the next game.
Best Rich could shoot would be 191. That's what Norm Duke has right now. Right. If he knocks down a single stick, he's a winner. Let's see if he goes shopping on lane 59.
Think we can handle that?
The two of us? Yeah. Yes. Yes. I saw you make the 10 pin in the tip.
The messenger says, out of here.
Norm Duke will advance into the semifinal game. Talk about intensity. I don't think he's going to relax until he wins.
He wants to be bowler of the year. That's his goal.
I hear you. Had a real good chance last year.
Made $144,000 last year with 9 telecasts. That's a lot of telecasts.
This is his 5th championship round appearance this year. A little Brooklyn help, not to be.
Right now he's inconsistent with his speeds, though. He's throwing it harder one time and slower another time. He's not consistent with that speed.
All right, solid game for Norm Duke, who comes up a winner. And, of course, coming up on Sunday, live from Princess Lanes in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, the Ladies Pro Bowlers Tour Three Rivers Open will come your way. Ladies back to work after a week off, and, of course, we'll bring you all the action live Sunday afternoon. Nice to see Rich Abboud with a smile. Well, he won his first game, but just couldn't get by Norm Duke.
Then he could wind up this game with 8 strikes and shoot 191 and lose the game. Norm Duke only had 5 strikes. 6, he had 6 strikes.
Well, that's what 4 opens will do for you, too, though.
Yeah. Play tic-tac-toe.
Is that feast or famine or what?
Yeah. He's going to have a double and maybe a 4-bagger in this game to shoot 191.
Home run, strikeout. Home run, strike.
That doesn't pay off too bad in baseball.
You're right.
In bowling, it's not the best.
Good friend of the PBA, first commissioner, who will be, basically retiring as of the end of December, although hopefully he'll be still involved with professional bowling. We'll have to wait and see. When we come back, a chat with our top seed. With the first 4, race to a very big lead, and Rich Abboud finished with the last 4, but it wasn't quite enough to get the job done. The final, Norm Duke winning 211 to 191. Time to head downstairs now to the best father and son professional bowling team that there is, and of course they are standing by with Mike Durbin.
Thank you, Denny, and I feel honored to be among this talented duo here. Let's talk to you first, Pete. You're the tournament leader this week. You've had tremendous success in this center. You won the U.S. Open here last year, won a couple regionals here. What do you think your chances are tonight?
Well, as long as I go up and make good shots and keep the ball in the play area, I think they're going to have to come and take it from me.
Okay, now if you win tonight, that's 19 titles. It gets you one closer to your dad's 26. We're going to take a look at a graphic here, kind of like father-like-son graphic. As we see right there, Dick, that's 34 years you've been bowling. That's older than you are, isn't it, Pete? Yeah. 26 titles, Pete, 13 years, 19 titles. They've already got you winning tonight. So what do you think, Dick? Looking at that, do you think he's going to catch you pretty quick?
Well, I hope so, Mike, because, you know, every father wants his son to follow in his footsteps, and I hope Pete does it, and I'm sure he will, because I know Pete's got confidence, and we have the confidence in him. So we're looking forward to tonight's match.
All right, Dick, I got to ask you, you know, you've been bowling all these 34 years, 26 titles. You've obviously competed a lot of times, but you've also sat back and watched Pete. Tell us, what's tougher, competing or watching?
The seat back there in the back is the toughest seat in the world. Out here on the approach, you're relaxed a little bit more, even though the butterflies fly around a little bit, but the seat is the toughest.
Okay, Pete, for you, you grew up the son of a Hall of Famer in a bowling family like that. Was that difficult for you? Did that put a lot of pressure on you?
It's tougher to sit and watch than it is to do it, because when you're doing it, it's something that you're natural. when you're just sitting there watching rooting, it's like this.
But what about growing up as son of a Hall of Famer? Did that put pressure on you?
Oh, I don't think so. I don't think it really added any pressure at all, because like Dad's always told me, be your own man out there, and I've always been my own man since I've come out, and we'll just see what happens.
Well, you've certainly been your own man, and we're going to find out if Norm Duke can continue to be his own man as he takes on the legend, Harry Sullins, who won here just a few years ago. We'll be right back.
Bowl with the world's greatest pro bowlers.
Big crowd here this evening at Woodland Bowl in Indianapolis, Indiana, and they've all come to watch the last couple of games now. Norm Duke and Harry Sullins in the semifinal. Whoever wins this one takes on Pete Weber.
Norm continuing to play outside on this left lane with good speed and going straight. That's too high.
Way too high. So more than likely an open frame in the opening frame for Norm Duke. Wasn't happy with that shot.
Interesting what he's doing. I mean, hooking it and playing inside on the one lane and throwing straight, playing outside on the other lane. Hard and straight at this fair, hoping for something good to happen. It didn't.
Harry Sullins up off the bench very quickly, would like to take advantage of Norm Duke's misfortune.
And Harry, in his four practice balls, I think threw three different balls or something like that. He didn't appear to be zeroed in.
Shopping around a little bit with equipment and with line. Inside, gives it a heavy crank, takes out the nine, or I should say the four, and leaves the nine.
That ball seemed to finish and then kind of quit right at the end. He's fortunate just to get away with just a nine pin.
Stretch out a little bit. 207 consecutive tournaments on the national tour.
The record being 236.
Sam Flanagan.
Harry, a four-step bowler, unusual style. Now watch, he's going to step here before he ever pushes the ball. Basically, it's a three-step approach from here on out. Now he pushes it out, and the timing, see, it's down here, and the ball's still going up, so it's way late. His upper body strength, which is enormous, he pulls that ball through. Pretty square at the line when he gets there. The foot's nice and straight. Just that late timing that he's able to, you know, repeat shots. It's amazing to me.
One earlier this year at the Showboat in Las Vegas, and double bounces a shot and ends up with a Brooklyn. Lucky he didn't break a finger.
A little double dribble there, that's all. Boom, boom.
Where was the whistle? Where are the zebras?
Watch this. As it comes down, slides out there, the timing's late again. Look at his wrist cup around it. Boom, and then boom. Boy, did that bounce out there a long way.
Norm Duke inside. Out and then back in for a strike on lane 6. You can hurt yourself double bouncing that thing.
Yes, I imagine you can. Pretty even between 59 and 60. Though I still feel he likes 59 better.
Talk to it all the way, and guess what? No one was listening. It's pocket 7-10.
Pocket 7-10. The head pin probably went in the front and the five pin behind. We get a good look at it right here. Watch the ball come in light. It'll barely get the five. The head pin goes in front, and the five just stops short. In fact, the head pin came off the wall and kind of interfered with the five. We have an interference call here, and he fouls.
almost bounced it out. 7-10. Wouldn't that have been a disaster? Make the 7-10 and have it taken away because of a foul. Oh. Not a good start for Norm Duke. Open on the left-hand lane.
And Sullins, who won a tournament earlier this year by bowling 175, says, I've been through this before.
Difficult condition all week long here in the Touring Players Championship. Rough was very high this week. Good speed, good firm shot, and a double as PBA Commissioner Mike Connor looks on. And next to him, President-elect of the PBA, and a great one from Indianapolis, Mike Albee.
Mike Albee. Tremendous individual, Mike is. Both Mikes.
Yeah.
Got a lot of Mikes around.
Albee's Army was on hand this week, and, boy, I'll tell you what, they were hooting and hollering last night when he had a chance for the telecast.
Yeah, he got up there with one game or two games to go with Bowl 180, and the 47th game kind of hurt him.
More conventional approach. Harry Sullins playing 59 and 60, almost the same.
And with tremendous speed, throwing the ball about 18 miles per hour and just drilling it in there.
And when you're throwing at 18 miles an hour and you're playing in on a slick condition at times.
It's just a fallback shot, man. I mean, basically, he's not playing for any hook at all.
Any number of ways to get to the pocket and strike. Norm Duke with a big swing on the right-hand lane. Another good shot there for Norm. He just has to double up on lane 59.
I'll be interested. Now let's watch how he throws this ball here. Inside the third arrow now. Remember when he was just slid out? That's how much this lane is broken down. But now, is he going to play the same shot on the left lane, or is he going to stay with the straight shot on the left lane? He's staying outside with the straight shot?
Needs a double bad.
Oh! Boy, nothing is going right for him this game. Finally makes the absolute perfect shot, leaves a solid eight. So that's two pocket hits the last two times on this lane, and the best he's going to come away with is one spare.
Demoralizing tap for Mr. Duke. That's going to put him right back in the match. But he'll have to figure out what to do the next trip around. Some great CFA college football coming your way on Saturday. Wisconsin playing at Indiana. That game kicks off at 12:30 p.m. on ESPN. And then a Heisman Trophy hopeful that runs probably a little better than Mike Durbin did in his collegiate days. Mr. Falk for San Diego State. They start at 7:30.
I would say a lot better.
You think?
A lot better.
Yeah, but you were quick back in those days.
Not that quick.
Aaron shot on the right-hand lane, but Rose says we'll take the six pin and try and get out of here.
See, that's the problem with trying to throw harder than your normal speed is. It's hard to be consistently accurate. We've seen Harry have two really wild shots on the Brooklyn side. He got one strike and leaves a six pin here. So right now his mistakes are big enough that they're not hurting him.
On a pair of lanes like this, you could liken it a little bit to golf with the players. Are they out there trying to shoot even par right now, Mike, figuring that might be good enough to win?
At this point in time, I think that's pretty close to it.
In other words, no double bogeys, no train wrecks, just nine spare is not all that bad.
And sneak in a double, you know, and stay clean. Mm-hmm. Don't give your an opponent an opportunity to beat you.
Through the nose, this time not as fortunate, and he leaves the baby split.
He's already throwing hard, so I'm assuming that he's going to move left and throw hard at this spare again. He won't throw too much harder at this spare than he's throwing at the strikes.
Out of Detroit, Michigan, 35-year-old Harry Sullins.
Blows in the thumb and then on the thumb. Doesn't like it.
Right on top of the three pin, an open frame and new life for Norm Duke. When we come back, the conclusion of the semifinal game. Is it Sullins or Duke that will face Pete Weber? Excellent shot on the right-hand lane for Norm Duke.
What he's been doing every time on this lane, starting inside the third arrow, swinging it out to about the 10th board. Everyone's looked the same on that lane. But you got to hit both lanes, as Rich Abboud found out the last game. He sticks, the ball goes left of target, needs some kind of fortuitous break. Doesn't get it, there's the five pin. And of course we know, Denny, nobody's missed the five pin since Chuck Pisano missed it back in the 1940s.
It's either, I think it was 38 or 39 actually. Oh, okay. And it was in league play at Paramus Bowling Center. And as far as we know, he's the only PBA Hall of Famer ever to miss the five pin and live to tell about it. Further inside, more of a fallback, and a four pin.
And right now he's happy with that. because that's enough. I mean, nine spare the rest of the game wins it for him. Well, maybe not. Certainly getting close.
Seventh frame action, $27,000 for first place this week in the Bud Light Touring Players Championship. Dave Ferraro was the defending champion. Dave with a check this week, but didn't quite get back into the finals. As far as I know, he's the only player ever to win this tournament twice, right?
Yes.
Dave Ferraro.
That's a very prestigious title among the players. They really want to win this title. 31 pins, only three frames left.
The other thing is it's a three-year exemption into the Firestone.
Correct.
See, well, he's moved left, and he's throwing harder and trying to get it to fall back, but he's running out of room.
He's just tightening up the line. I mean, not a whole lot of hook there.
Filling frames right now, but when you're 30 ahead, sometimes that's more than enough.
He's throwing that ball 18.7 miles per hour in the first ball. Not a whole lot harder than that at the spare.
Probably slows down.
Well, Duke, again, has to keep striking on this right lane. When you've got one lane, you can't miss it.
Has room for 205. Possibility of a tie.
Possibility.
Boy, he's made some nice shots on this right-hand lane. Look at this. If you took the last three shots on that lane, Mike, there wouldn't be a fraction of a difference. And yet the left-hand lane, he just can't seem to figure it out. Of course, he threw the one great shot and left the solid 8-pin. Pocket 7-10.
Then he stood up on the approach like he was going to move inside. Now, I don't know what he's going to do at this point in time. But I know that if he wants to win this match, which, of course, we know that he does, he's got to figure out a way to strike on lane 59. And he's staying with the outside. Not much chance. Up Brooklyn.
Oh, he's come to life, got a big time break, runs off the approach, sits down and says, hallelujah, I'll take the Brooklyn.
I'll take it. And believe me, if he comes out and bails this game out, I think we're going to see a change of angle the next game on that left lane. Sullins now, the thinking is entirely different. He's been defensive the last three straight frames, four frames, in fact. Now he's got a strike.
Pulled it all the way. And that was the biggest break of the week for Harry Sullins, who ended breaks up right on the nose.
I mean, that could have been 6 and 8 out. He winds up with 9 potential spares. Pete Weber came over to watch.
But he was up early, pulled it all the way.
Right through the 1, 2, 3. Comes away with 9.
Big time break there.
And a spare. If you're Norm Duke, though, you're looking at it from the point of view, just don't let him double. If he doesn't double, I can win the match.
Right. Little maintenance on the sliding shoe. Harry trying to slow down, stay into his pre-shot routine, do what you have to do to throw a couple of strikes.
He's just looking right now to get one strike in. He hasn't had a strike since the fourth frame.
Break and couldn't quite get it. Ends up with a 4-pin. Norm Duke Knight now realizes he can win the match.
He can win the match.
And you know what?
He hasn't
the good
missed
news
that
is
right
the right hand lane.
Hasn't missed that lane.
Oh my, would this be a turnaround? Of course, if you're Sullins, you spare up and get the count because then he's got to throw at least a double to get you.
He's got to get 2 and 9. If he spare strikes, he must have 2 and 9. A tie is still in the works. And Harry spares it up. Strike is 203.
It's been one of those gut-wrenching tight games for Harry Sullins because he got ahead. He wasn't comfortable, wasn't throwing the ball great, but he's done what he had to do to give himself a chance to win. But you're never comfortable in that situation.
Well, right now, he's still thinking, I want to strike on this fill ball to make him get as much as he has to get.
Left again. Well, and a Brooklyn.
He watched Duke get a Brooklyn over there. He says, if you can do it, I can too.
These guys are hanging on for dear life right now.
Well, hanging on won't cut it right now. Duke's got to, as they say, fish or cut bait. He's got to strike.
You mentioned this guy right now is the guy they feel is the best player in the world in the clutch.
Oh, he trips off the four at the last moment. Now he needs another one. A little slow on the speed.
Just soft on that speed. Watch the two-pin, third from the left. It finishes hard. And the old Billy Hardwick tap on that four-pin.
That's the longest 3 seconds of the week when you're waiting for that four to go down. Speed. Light hit, 10 pin stands, and oh, what a relief for Harry Sullins, who survives a really tough semifinal match.
Great shot.
Woo.
He picked up the speed, he swung it out, he trusted it all the way. To leave a 10 pin on that shot is unusual.
A classy shot, great effort. Harry Sullins hangs on. Norm Duke finishes third. When we come back, Sullins and Weber for the Touring Players title.
What?
Nobody beats Midas. Nobody. All right, looks like a championship frame. Game number one. It happened in the 10th frame for Justin Hromek.
Justin had to strike in order to have a chance to win this match. Made a good shot. You see, swings it out. Ball comes into the 1-3 pocket. Doesn't get the kiss on the 10. That meant that Rich Abboud won that first match.
Six pin just kind of laid there. Rich hung on to win. 221 to 215 in a very close opening match here in Indianapolis. And it was on to game number two. This time it's Norm Duke in the fourth frame early on.
And Norm Duke used the old match game style, strike early and often, and he got out way ahead. This was the fourth one in a row. Rich Abboud never had any trouble with this lane 59 that Duke is on, but he had a lot of trouble with lane 60.
So Norm started fast, got out to the big lead. And there you see the Morris code or tic-tac-toe game that was bowled by Rich Abboud. Had a bunch of strikes, but it was 211 to 191 in game number two. Then Norm Duke, 10th frame, had to have the double to advance.
He'd already gotten the first one with the trip four, sends it out wide. The ball comes in light and leaves the 10 pin. And a disappointment on Norm Duke's face.
Threw a wonderful shot that didn't quite finish with a strike. And Norm says, I did everything I could. The final, 203 to 194. The legend, Harry Sullins, against a legend without question, Pete Weber, has 18 titles, looking for 19. Don't go away. We'll be back with a title match right after this. Down to the final two, Pete Weber, Harry Sullins. They qualified 1-2, so they might as well bowl each other for the title.
Yeah, they earned the right to be here.
Harry Sullins escaping in the semifinal game, so he's looking at a new life without question.
Pete Weber was throwing some strikes in practice. He gets six practice balls when he comes over. He threw some strikes.
I have a feeling Harry's probably very much aware of that. So he wants to open up with a few of his own. And right now, he does not have the mental picture of how to play this pair of lanes right now, Michael. He is just not playing them the right way.
Not at all.
He's been left to the head pin like 6 out of 12 shots.
When that ball hooks early on you, Dan, it's very difficult to make the adjustment. I mean, your natural instinct is to move left and try and find more oil, but he's not doing that. He's not finding it. When he moves left, it's still hooking early.
Right. So that means you got to move right.
Well, he hasn't tried that. I mean, he ground out a win from the other side.
Right. Pete Weber with a nice smooth stroke leaves a 10 pin on lane 60 with his opening shot.
But you can see a much better ball reaction than Harry Sullins. His ball didn't come early. His ball skidded through the lane and made the move at the back end in the pocket.
Of course, the other side of that argument is Harry won the last game.
That's what he's saying, Dan.
Well, but he's in his comfort zone. He does not want to move right, obviously.
Obviously.
Because if he had any kind of chance, he would. So maybe he feels his best chance to win this title is from right where he is. Brooklyn or no Brooklyn.
Brooklyn or whatever, whatever. He has to carry a nosedive.
I just don't think you're going to win it with 190.
Well,
we'll see.
He won it with 2-0 last game.
I know. That's why I'm telling myself he may be approaching this from the right perspective. I love this. I love these tough lane conditions. Guys got to dig in there and figure out what to do. Doubles a big thing. Weber breaks up a split. I mean, this is just what it's all about, right? Heck with those high scores. What do you care about, 240s and 250s and all that stuff? Kim said, I don't care if Pete shoots 2-0 to win this title.
As long as he wins.
Right.
But like you say, it's gut-wrenching.
Oh, I mean, every shot's tough. I mean, there is no gimme out there right now. It's not an automatic strike zone. You know, line up, throw it right, hit it as hard as you can, and watch the ball just dice up the pins. You do that now, you're liable to end up with a handful.
Well, you can do that, you know, but you still got to get into the 1-3. You got to hit what you're looking at.
And you got to take what the lanes are giving you, which is my argument about Harry Sullins. The lanes are not giving him that shot.
Well, your argument's well found. He has been high or Brooklyn 8 consecutive shots.
Now, this ball went a little right.
Still high. That's there. 9 consecutive shots.
I guess my question is
he's
ball
waiting
hooks.
For the carry down. That's what he's doing, Dan.
The ball has hooked back every single time. So if you threw it another 2 or 3 boards right, don't you think you'd get back to the pocket?
Well, I'm
he
sure
doesn't
that,
want to open
I'm,
up the lane.
I'm sure that thought has occurred to him.
I'm sure it has, too.
You know, but he's chosen. Four pin on the left. He's chosen for his game plan
right.
Hard and tight. I mean, he has not given the ball room one time in a game in 2 frames.
When you approached a championship round pair, I mean, did you go in with like an A, a B, and a C game plan, or did you go in with an A and I'm going to make this work no matter what?
If I were lost like him, I would probably be doing similar thing that he's doing, trying to just find a way to get the ball to 1-3
right.
And hope that I get a strike or 2 in a row. Mm-hmm. Now, he gave that room.
Right.
You see the result. Dan.
That's why he has it. Okay, he just answered my question.
Yep.
Harry, hang in there. I had a feeling that's what it was.
Well, after 9 straight shots going high, sooner or later you're going to give it room, but there's the result. I mean, really, I think the only chance he has to win this match is to watch Pete Weber and move to that line. Mm-hmm. That's my feeling.
Of course, equipment really is going to play a big role in what happens here, too, because his ball does not seem to be overreacting like Harry's, but he's also playing a much different angle.
Much different. And we see at 15 feet at board 17 out to board 11. That's a 6-board head belly and got out to 90 and a half board at 45 feet, 18 miles an hour. Mm-hmm. Just not, you can't belly it that much. You get it back from in there.
Not throwing it that hard. Now, slower speed for Weber. Carries the strike, covers more boards, and has a nice even round reaction.
Is Dick and Juanita look on? Can he blow that?
Oh, look at Richard. Better loosen that tie, Pro. Look at him. He's struggling.
Classic style of Pete Weber. 5-step delivery. Very little push weight. Kind of just drops it down. Now, look at how high that backswing is. Short, quick third step. Perfect finish. For the double.
Ooh, that was the strike of a champion right there. Doubled up, put the pressure right on Harry Sullins. And let's see what Harry can come up with here on the right-hand lane. Boy, if he could get a double, he's right back in this thing.
Swings it out. About to the 7th, 6th board. Nice medium speed. If he doesn't win this match, something's wrong. 16 point. He's throwing it 2 miles an hour slower than Sullins. I think Harry has moved. Yeah, he did move a little right. Still high.
Oh, look at Harry Sullins get a break there. He's saying, all right, I made a move. That didn't work. Now let me get to the left-hand lane and see if I can figure out how to get a strike.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, he's having a tough time out there.
Right through. We set a nosedive right through the 1-2-3. He's got grandma's teeth up there, and they all get pulled.
Quick trip to the dentist there. It all looks the same in the 4th frame with a strike. A double here puts him back into the match, down by just 2.
And he's totally lost, Dan. I mean, he doesn't know where to stand or where to throw.
I think he's moved right on the right-hand lane, too, Mike. Or the left-hand lane.
Yeah, he did. He moved right. All same right. result, though.
But at least a chance to get to the pocket.
Yeah.
Moving with every shot and also realizing that Pete's pretty well lined up. You might as well take some gambles at this stage.
Absolutely. Exactly.
Spare up for Harry Sullins, who is grinding it out, as they say. 27,000 on top, 14 for second. And a rather nice prize list for the pros this week. And Pete Weber, currently third all time. If he wins tonight, he will move past one of the greatest of all time, Mark Rahm.
Who withdrew?
All right, now Pete Weber is putting on a clinic in terms of how to play this championship pair. But I guess the point I'm making, his style is a lot different. He's able to do this. Maybe Harry isn't as good as throwing it slow and hooking it more.
Well, he's just stroking the ball. He just looks so pretty out there throwing. And look at the eyes. Those are the eyes of somebody who knows he has the advantage. It's going to take full advantage of what he has.
Yeah, he's seen the blood, believe me.
Exactly. The piranha is out, and he's going to chew him up.
He's going to end it early, if at all possible. Ahead by 22, could be 32 with an X here. And right now, Harry Sullins is playing for second.
He can't finish any worse than that, Dad. Look at the eyes again. Look at them. Well, I mean to tell you.
Does the word possessed mean anything to you?
You know, I never saw his father get that intense.
Man, he wants to win bad.
Well, you know, he's won the Triple Crown. This is another major title that he's going to add to his collection. And Harry says, well, I'm just pacing.
Yeah, pretty much. Terrific week for Harry Sullins, who, as I mentioned, came within a game of leading this tournament. But when he came out to play here this evening, he just was not able to match ball and motion and game to this pair of lanes as well as Pete has.
Well, it's all in ball reaction, and Harry has no ball reaction, where Pete has a tremendous one. I mean, it's choice of equipment, it's speed, it's hand release, it's experience, and somewhat, it's that, what they say, the eye of the tiger. It appears that Pete Weber has that tonight.
Hit finally right of the pocket. Harry explodes the rack. Don't count him out yet.
Well, he still has a potential 234 if he would wire it out. Stranger things have happened. Look at those earnings last year. He only bowled half the year, $144,000.
Looking to keep the string alive, and he does. Pete Weber waltzing to victory number 19.
It's closer to his dad's 26 all the time. Boy, look at how much he's swinging that ball out. What a great shot that is.
Want to talk about coming off the hand clean. Oh. Huh? That thumb's out for about a half a second, and those fingers are still in there.
And look at how much more relaxed his dad looks now. Although he hasn't gotten it written up yet.
You won't see any smiles from Weber until it's all over. Until it's in the book. You hear Pete, he said, that better hook.
Come
he
back.
He made a mistake and said, you know, I'll take just the 10 without the 7. See, the pros don't throw a great shot every time.
Not every time.
But, look at Peter. He's a little worried about that last one.
He gives this one a lot of rope. About now he's saying, that ball better hook, and it did. But it leaves the 10. Pete talking to it pretty quick.
That better lips, hook.
Come back.
Just like a league player when you throw a little errant shot. Come on, baby, come back and hit the pocket.
Now, Sullins has got a strike here to have any chance. Gave it room.
Did not have the right shot. Did not have the right equipment, I don't think, do you? Who knows? He went a little right, it didn't come back, and when he set it a little short, it went dead left. That's not a good combination.
It's just interesting that one guy is aiming at a crack, and the other guy appears to be aiming at five boards.
Yep. That's what's incredible about this game. It's very difficult to explain to people at home. Harry Sullins is trying his heart out right now and can barely get the ball in the pocket two shots in a row, and Pete Weber's out there just gliding. He's got it on autopilot. The importance of learning proper lane play, matching the right cover, the right weights, the right ball to whatever lanes that you're playing on. Good shot here. Figured the left-hand lane out, but much too late.
Much too late. Pete Weber just cruising along. Dressed in his Gary Player black.
Ooh,
my goodness.
How about
over yet?
4 out of 10. That was way short and a little slow.
Way short. And it's the 3, 4, 6, 7, 9, 10. Hits the head pin through the heart of the pins and gets 4. What's he going to do to try and make this dent? That's a Durbin with the 4-7.
It's a tricky shot. But if anybody can make it.
No chance. He played for just getting as many as he could. 8, that gives him 199. He needs a mark. He needs a mark, Dennis. It's come down to this. I mean, one frame made that big a difference. He needs a mark to lock Harry Sullins out.
So the conservative Harry Sullins isn't out of this yet.
I mean, we've been giving this title to Pete Weber for 6 frames now.
You're
not kidding. It comes down to the 10th frame, and he needs a mark.
Why do we do that? Harry just wants a chance.
A lot of room. He's happy with just that. He says, I can make that. Made it twice already this game, and I can make it. But he's got to. If he doesn't make it, Sullins could stand up in the 10th frame and get 2 in the 10th and win this title. Steal it, actually. Very little time.
Hard and straight. But that right there is what you pay for. When you put your money down, you commit to throw a shot, hit the pocket, or throw a quality shot like that when a title is on the line, then leave a 10-pin, walk up there, and just drill it. I mean, that's what it's all about out here. I mean, that's serious pressure.
That's a Weber.
Yeah, well, that's a winner, no matter who it is. When you see that, that's, you know, that's professional bowling at its finest. That's not an easy thing to do. Pete taking a good look at the board.
He needs 5. 6.
Johnny Petraglia, our statistician this week, PBA Hall of Famer, says he needs half a dozen to lock it up. And a strike will do just fine. Harry Sullins, a gutsy performance. He hung in there to the bitter end and had an outside chance, but Pete Weber comes away with the Bud Light Touring Players Championship with a wonderful 219 game.
A recent university study confirms something that has millions of asthma sufferers breathing easier. Clinic.
Final score, 219 to 192. Pete Weber, a winner here in the Touring Players Championship. And Peter, a marvelous victory for you.
Well, thank you, Denny. It's nice to be back in the winner's circle after a year and a half drought. So, and I didn't do anything different. I brought mom and dad up, my wife, Kim, and her mother-in-law, or my mother-in-law up. And that's the same crew I had here. My cousins Matt and Laura were the same crew I had here for the U.S. Open. It couldn't have been any better.
All right, so you'll be making travel arrangements next year for all those people. Pat Burns from Bud Light has a beautiful trophy for you.
Here, Pete, on behalf of Budweiser, the Anheuser-Busch family, and Bud Light, here's the trophy. Congratulations.
Yes, the eagle has landed here at Woodland Bowl. And Jim, you also have a beautiful check.
On behalf of Bud Light and the Central and Ab Bowling Prior Association, the eagle has landed. Congratulations, Pete.
Thank you, Jim. Speaking for the PBA, it's always a pleasure to come to Woodland Bowl. It's always one of the best stops we've ever come to, and it's one stop we always look forward to come to. And Jim Doty and Don Mitchell couldn't be better hosts for us. Bud Light, couldn't ask for a better sponsor. They do come from the right city, so. Long live Bud Light, long live Woodland Bowl.
And we'll be back to further chat with the winner of the Touring Players Championship, Pete Weber, right after this. Another major title for you, Peter.
Well, it's my fifth major now, and it seems that when the majors come around, I come to the top, and it's just a great thrill to have this many major titles to my credit.
All right, so long, everybody, from Indianapolis.